Good morning. It's a great pleasure and an honor to be here speaking at DEVELOP3D Live. And I have to say, before I start, that I didn't actually know what I was going to talk about today when I accepted coming here, until Dan Staples from Siemens said something about my nonlinear thinking. And that surprised me. I didn't know my thinking was nonlinear, but it's basically what the subject of my talk is going to be today. And so what better than to talk to you about the unplanned and non-linear journey I've been on over the last few years, starting out as an artist in southwest France and inventing and developing a modular, and I'm going to try and say it, reconfigurable, scalable robot system, and taking it through to first customers, and one of whom is CERN, the Subatomic Physics Research Institute in Geneva, which is about one of the toughest customers you can think of for a robot company. So we are really a very small company. There are just a very few of us, and we're up against some major players in the industry. But Bill Gates said something years back in an interview, I recall, that it's really the little guys working out of garages that you need to look out for, and that's really where we've come from, left of field. CERN is an interesting place, and we've got to know it quite well over the years because we've been going there and delivering our robots and working with the engineers. They have some of these robots running around in the Hadron Collider, and what they need is to replace people with machines, intelligent, capable, adaptable machines. And that's because the background radiation is bad enough for machines, let alone people, but also the magnetic fields there would kill someone. So there's no option. It has to be done by machines. But the differentiator that we've got is that our system is modular, so it can be reconfigured and the robots can be retasked to perform many different engineering tasks in the Hadron Collider, whilst the system itself is standardized, which is a great advantage to any new adopter that doesn't want to have too much complexity and cost. We are commercially very early stage, and we are working with other customers, a little like CERN, who need to replace people with machines. And we are really addressing what's often talked about as dull, dirty, and dangerous tasks, those difficult tasks that people shouldn't be performing. But there's another requirement that we address, and that is the adaptability of the system. This is really critical. It is the fact that our system is modular means you can swap out motor modules or power modules as if anything goes wrong or as situations develop, and keep the system running 24/7. And that takes out a whole burden of support and maintenance for the customer. And that's often the critical factor. It's not just the fact that the robots can do lots of different things. It's the fact that they're actually easy and cost-effective to adopt. So the background to even speaking to you today here is that none of this was at all predictable. I mean, I didn't know what I was embarking on. And it was not certain at any stage that any of this would work out. We'd get to the next level, developing this and taking it right through to a product. And the background to this is that my wife and I are far from risk averse. We have a tiresome tendency in our lives to keep taking the difficult option, the risky option, over the easy one, and getting ourselves into a very tight fix. So we moved out to France with our three-year-old son many years ago and restored a very large barn. And this is an image of the roof of the barn during the restoration process. And there was just the two of us and a crane and a three-year-old doing this. And this restoration project took 13 years. And there were some quite tricky moments, as you can probably imagine, in getting there. We ended up with a very nice house and lots of studios in the house and a very creative result. But what I took away from this, and it's become part of how I view the creative process, is an extreme flexibility of mind and of method and that's really fed into how I actually work. I'm really an accidental roboticist, and most of my life I've worked as an artist. I was a caricaturist on newspapers in the UK, I wrote books, I've made ceramics, I've made furniture, I've all sorts of stuff, but nothing to do with engineering. So when it came to engineering, I had nothing to fall back on except what I knew as an artist. This is a caricature of the writer Samuel Beckett. It's actually an etching. And I actually sent a copy of this, a print to Samuel Beckett shortly before he died, by post, and it came back the next day slightly crumpled. So in my family, there's going back generations, there have been artists and engineers, writers, painters, what have you, often all in the same person at once. And I've kind of followed in their footsteps. And a lot of my preoccupations are with patterns in nature and overlaid textures and forms and rhythms, and also in an analytical interest in what makes those come about. And I think that in the creative process, it's very useful to look for ideas, inspiration, resources just about anywhere. And part of what I think there's almost a formulation that the more disparate some of those inspirations are, and as you bring them together, you converge them, sometimes the greater the excitement in what results, the greater the newness. This preoccupation with simple forms which overlaid can create complexity, as I've started to realize over the years, is something that is what I think about whatever I do. This is a painting, a small study for a bigger semi-abstract seascape, actually. And what I was doing in this, you'll see, is creating very simplified forms, trying to build up a language, a visual language of the landscape with the headland, reflections, the sea, the sky, sand flats in the foreground, etc. But the interest there is in trying to forge a language and trying to tease out a new way of seeing a landscape. But also underneath this is that theme of simplicity overlaid over simplicity creates complexity. So even my choice of dog is governed by some of these preoccupations, creative, artistic, scientific, if you like. This is a Giacometti sculpture of a Saluki. It's a sight hound, a big, tall, long-legged hunting dog. And you can see the long limbs for the long gait, the deep rib cage for the big lung capacity, the long tail to counterbalance the dog as he runs and to dampen movement. And this is our Saluki enjoying the seaside, and you see his forms. And just being around a dog like this on a daily basis is a wonderful opportunity to study how he functions, how he moves, to get terribly familiar with his structure, or even to study things like, because he's a desert dog, how the little hairs in his paws make him very good at running on very soft sand. Because I've been pulled along by him on a lead, and he's very powerful. But some of these ideas trickle down into other things like the robotics. So you start with the dog, you end up with the robot. In France, I was running my own architectural landscape design company. And what I was trying to do, amongst other things, was to understand the vernacular architecture of the region. And this meant reverse engineering buildings and trying to understand the methods and the materials that were used. And the pigeonnier on the right-hand side, which is a pigeon tower, is something I actually built myself. It's a 3-story, 7.5-meter tower from retrieved stone and so on. What I was trying to do here was to essentialize the form, and it was inspired in part by this stubby-looking cactus-like actual palm tree. You see a similarity in the forms, because both are designed to survive the cold winters and the hot summers of the region, and there's a kind of logic in their forms. So they share a form and functional relationship, but there's something else, I think, that they share. And that is the caricaturist in me sees something somewhat comic about that reduction, you know, ad absurdum, taking something to the nth degree and teasing out its essential characteristics. They actually start to look quite funny, well, in my mind. So following this theme through of the creative process and how it works, at university I found myself studying literature and unpicking other people's works and trying to understand, you know, how they were created and what were the major factors that made them work or not work. And one one very interesting issue started to come up all the time. That was this dichotomy between the rational mind and the instinctive. The fact that both are required in the creative process in differing degrees at different stages in the process. And there's a real tug of war, and it's a difficult thing to resolve. So because I was more interested in creating than in taking apart other people's works, I started to look for guidelines for the creative process. And I stumbled on the works of Thomas Aquinas, who was a philosopher who created a system of aesthetics, a transcendental system of aesthetics, which tries to link the rational mind with the spiritual. And what appealed to me in this was a three-word formulation that emerges from his writings. He didn't actually formulate this himself. It's been done after his time. But the three words I keep in mind when I'm working, and what they mean, and I find them really helpful toggles, is the first one, integritas, means that there's nothing extra and nothing missing from something. So if you say, think of a Jane Austen novel, you know, they're really concise, jewel-like constructions. If they rambled on a bit, then they'd be less powerful. Consonantia, very useful concept, is that every part is proportional to its function, regardless of its own size, within a system. And claritas is an interesting concept. It's that moment when a creation comes together and it starts to become more than the sum of its parts. It becomes holistic. It sort of starts to have a meaning of its own. And it doesn't happen very often, but it's great when it does. When you start almost seeing, oh, right, that's happening because of that, and isn't that fantastic? A big payoff. So it becomes a very clear design. So part of my unpicking of the creative process is also to look at formalist principles in art and to work out how compositions work. So going back to that painting of mine, a lot of that's about trying to find tension and release in a composition, movement and stasis. And so in this painting by Vermeer, which is called The Art of Painting, there are a lot of things one could say about it, about the way the paint's put on the surface, the use of light, the depth, etc. But you could also talk about the compositional motifs and what makes us a strong image. And by superimposing some brightly colored lines, you get rectangles and a square, and it's their relative proportions and shapes that give this painting both a static quality, a tension, and a release. And if you then superimpose little lines over the painter and the subject and the light fitting, you find a triangulation which is actually gives the whole painting movement. And these are principles that I've kind of thought about for many years and got used to. And so they're kind of bubbling away there in my mind the whole time when I'm designing anything. So it might be literally, you know, part of the deck of the robot or the wheel or something. I'm actually thinking in these terms. But there's something else, I think, in the creative process that is very interesting over and above unpicking the different elements of it, and that is creative intensity. So this painting by Kandinsky of his garden is painted in the early 1900s. It's just a detail of the painting. Is interesting to me because it's got a sort of exuberance. It captures the bright, fresh brilliance of a new day. But it's also very different to what came before. What I think is happening here is there's a huge creative pressure brought to bear on his source materials, and he's transformed them completely, and something completely new has emerged at the other end of the process. So what I take from this is keeping the design development process very open as long as possible, and allowing it to digest its source materials and not shutting down the process too early, letting it evolve, letting it run. Going from the sublime to the very everyday, this is a children's book I wrote and illustrated about warring hares and rabbits, and it involves the theft of carrots and a large Trojan carrot. What I want to say about this is that whilst it was for children, the composition on the right-hand side of the battle scene owes a lot to Japanese prints with the strong diagonals and the main features slipping out of view, like the towers and things. So again, plunder, steal, borrow wherever possible. That would be the message I would take, you know, from this. In France, we were surrounded by vineyards and sunflower fields, and the sunflower head is an interesting study in cramming as much as possible into as small a space as possible. In this case, seeds into the head of the sunflower, and it's no accident that the seeds are arranged in counter-rotating spirals from the center of the head, and that the number of spirals falls into a sequence of the Fibonacci series depending on the size of the sunflower. Or taking the similar spiral here, which evolves through adjacent squares, and the proportions of those squares are in the golden mean. So what I take from this is that there's some very interesting mathematical and sequence principles out there in the real world that are useful in the design process. And curiously, when I was designing my 3D modular system, the same numbers started coming up on my calculator when I was analyzing it, and I couldn't work them out. And I discovered that it scaled in increments of 1.618%. And when I tried a design around to try and get away from this and see another way of doing it, I couldn't. It just seemed to have to be that way. So sometimes, maybe the numbers were there lurking in the design, and you just discover them later. Or maybe you could just use the numbers to help make a design come about. In France, before any of the robots happened, I was running my design architecture and landscape design business and trying to interpret customers' requirements and delivering projects on time and on cost, etc., as one does, a very conventional process. I was also pushing the boundaries and trying new techniques, and this building was cast in situ to look like it had been made out of stone, and the customer was very happy, etc. But I found also another really interesting factor in this work was that when there was a problem, a really big red flag in the process, something that had to be resolved, that was often where the best ideas came from. So maybe they had a tricky neighbor, or they didn't want to see a view, or there was land slippage. That would be the beginning of the answer and the beginning of something quite interesting and innovative. So there I was in France, happily running my business, writing books, painting, all sorts of flaky creative things. And then I was thinking about my children's construction toys and wondering why they had so many special little bits and didn't do very much. And certainly in my mind, they weren't very creative. So I started wondering if they weren't just two-dimensional, whether there was such a thing as three-dimensional modularity. And this is a sketchbook from that time, and I was just fiddling around with some ideas and pondering what three-dimensional modularity might look like. And I was actually trying to draw the parts with what little technical drawing I could remember from school when a friend of mine working at Aerospatiale on the big jets was really horrified and saw what I was up to. He said, "Well, you must be about the last person on the planet trying to draw things anymore." And so he introduced me to some CAD software called Solid Edge. And within days, I was completely addicted to this and lying to the rest of the family and saying, "I'll just do it an hour's work," and then doing a whole night and then, you know, bringing people coffee in the morning, because it became an addictive process to try and work out 3D modularity in CAD. And I went on maths websites and tried to understand what would really powerful 3D modularity look like, be. And the mathematicians were very blasé about this. They said it's one part that reconfigures and assembles with identical cousins to create an infinite number of topologies. So I thought, that's a great challenge, let's go for it. And fortunately at the time, I didn't look at what anyone else had done. I didn't look at the prior art, and I also didn't, for some curious reason, think it couldn't be done. Incidentally, that's not how I work any longer. I often think things probably can't be done, but still try to do them. And I do also look at prior art now before I launch into something. But I try to push that investigative process back a bit. I try to evolve an idea before I look at anything else. So I did actually get the system down to a single part that reconfigures with identical cousins and file a patent that then went straight through and wasn't contested in examinations. And then because my focus is on children's toys, I developed it into a toy system and came within a hairbreadth of selling a license to a major international toy company. But I wouldn't be here today if that had happened. I think I'd be lying on a beach somewhere, probably very bored. So there's the dragster car that the toy system could make. It could make very sophisticated toys with very few different parts. And it still could do. And it could make great educational systems. And we've ran 3 years of trials in schools in France where it worked brilliantly as an educational toy in robotic form, actually. But the picture on the right-hand side, you see, is very different to the one on the left. And yet they're the same system. And what happened in that transition was I started looking at these dull, dirty, and dangerous requirements, this huge emerging requirement all around the world for machines, intelligent, capable machines that could replace people. I thought, that's really what we should be doing. But look at the long list of requirements. So I hadn't got a company at this stage, didn't really have any money to throw at the problem. It was just me, and all this needed to be done. Incidentally, that's one of our robots going down a sewer in Docklands. So one of the first challenges was, how do you make a modular, robust system that might be used by people on a dark night with big gloved hands, feeling very stressed? How do you make it so it can be instantly reconfigured without tools, locked together, and work really reliably? Because you've got to not only lock it physically together in the three planes, you've got to also transmit lots of power and lots of data. I tried a whole range of connectors, some extremely expensive military-grade connectors, amongst others, and nothing did what we wanted. And so it then became apparent that really what was needed was to develop our own connector, and we formed a company and actually had a little bit of funds to throw at the problem. And the solution was not to try and make a connector the way connector companies make connectors, because I didn't know anything about it, and that wasn't even an option. What I knew was geometries, forms, sequences, patterns that overlaid, and that's basically what I did. I made structures in 3D that interlock and work together and then create through a selective metallization process that I developed a three-dimensional connecting principle that can be axially and orthogonally repositionable and that can carry very large amounts of power. We can have 60-amp transients and 4 or 8-pin Ethernet. And it's also got a lot of other characteristics. It's vibration tolerant, it's tolerant of ingress of foreign matter, it's non-magnetic, it's low cost to manufacture, it's very lightweight, and so on and so forth. And so this is actually what you see on the top of this robot. Here, if you look at the deck of the robot, you see a set of little sockets. That's really the core of the system. You can plug systems together, you could take this robot apart, there are four motor modules on this robot, each one of which is a robot in itself. It's got a CPU, it's got comms, it's got accelerometers. We've actually run one of these motor modules as a robot with small traction systems down small pipes in the London Underground. So it doesn't have to be like that, but the principle it only holds if you use this connectivity to get there. So even the wheels join onto the robot with the same connectivity principle. So what that would allow for in the future development would be to have either hub drives or even the batteries in the wheels, so you could take the power and the data through the wheels. Another challenge that we had to be met was that to be useful to our customers, these robots need to take a whole range of sensors and tools, like manipulator arms, they might be cutters, they might be drills, into very difficult to access places reliably. And wheels and tracks didn't seem to do a very good job. In fact, they were terrible. And so I started thinking, well, what does work? And arthropods, like this cockroach, do a great job in what you call unstructured environments. That's an environment that you can't know before you go into it. You just don't know what you're going to be up against. Say it's an earthquake zone. And the way they seem to do their job is that they have have a passive adaptive system where the rigidities and the compliances and the proportions of their limbs and the very simple drive mechanism, the stabbing gait mechanism, means that it self-adapts to a complex terrain type. So we didn't want to build a mechanical cockroach, because being British and cheapskate, we weren't up to that. I mean, there are others who do make very sophisticated imitations, biomimetics of living creatures. That wasn't an option. So really the option was to look at revolute actuation, which is a fancy word for a wheel, and think, could we get a legged gait onto a wheel? And the result was these big claw-like devices. And what makes them work over very complex terrain is the geometries and the choice materials and the sequencing, their exact spacing. And if they're different, they don't work. They have to have those geometries. And that took, the process was this process I was talking about earlier, this creative process of looking for ideas from all sorts of different sources and bringing them together and then allowing them to bubble up and transform into something completely new. And when I first ran one of these over bramble bushes at Dungeness, it kind of created a riot on a bank holiday weekend with people all dogs barking and people clapping and things, because the robot could just go over just about anything with these things. There's the robot putting a little foot out onto a step, and it up it goes. But you see also the robot's crawling on its belly, and this was another factor, was to keep the center of gravity of the robot low and to give the robot a secondary traction system. So these belts underneath the robot just are driven by the existing traction system. So there's no addition of complexity and cost, really, to the system. But by yoking the drives, because each of these motors drives a wheel, by yoking two motors with a belt that is designed to slip a certain amount on the drives, and putting the belt at the right position under the belly of the robot, you see a small robot here climbing over a railway track. And what's good about that is, unlike, say, endless ground-laying tracks, you don't go very high over the obstacle. Your trajectory is very low, it's very energy efficient, it's very easy to control the robot, and it just does it of its own accord. It doesn't need any higher level intelligence, as with the claws device in the higher images. So when you combine all those, you get all sorts of interesting results. For instance, the slave tracks, as we call them, provide a differential assistance between the motors. So we were able then to put very small motors into the robot with very small batteries to achieve major results. Big payload carrying 11 hours of endurance with this robot on standard batteries, because the system is very lightweight. It's like we fought our way out of the performance envelope by finding other ways of getting this thing to move. Another preoccupation has been trying to make sure that our robots don't fall apart on our customers, because they really need them to keep running. And a lot of the design work I'm now involved in is making the robots monolithic, so that the loom and other, even some of the electronics, is actually in the structures of the robot. That's a cube from... Some of the robots are configured around cubes, and that cube has very few parts. It's put together in a very short time, and the assembler doesn't realize what they're doing, but there are data channels and power channels in that. Every single lithium-ion cell is monitored individually, but there's no wiring, so there's very little to fall apart. And going back to my Saluki and thinking about how he moves, another interesting area of development has been to bring compliance into the robots so that they flex and distort as they move. And incidentally, the only time we've ever had something break off a robot was when a stainless steel shaft broke off a gearbox. And the plastics, and these are metallized plastics, didn't fail. They don't fail because they flex and they change shape. And you see circles around parts of the robot that flex. So the center of the robot flexes, all the linkages flex, all the connector is designed so everything can move a certain amount but not too much. There's a flexibility in the traction system, and also putting tails out the back of the robots to dampen movement and to help the trajectory and kill unwanted movement. And of course, when you're designing a system, you're starting to create the first baby steps towards a brand. And what I've been doing is trying to stay true to the original impulse, which is a practical, everyday system that whose geometries make it legible, its function is legible in the form. So this is the core to a robot we call the armadillo that you might have seen on if you use Solid Edge. It's being used this year as a tool for showing the functionalities of Solid Edge. And the user can see how the system works in the geometries, and there are no abstract forms on this. So it's all primitives. At most, there's a 45-degree bevel. It's all circles, cubes, rectangles, etc. And so that sort of comes back to my painting, the abstract, reducing things to the simplest, to the essential, trying to essentialize the form. And sometimes I think even slightly comic ideas like the claws, which actually looks slightly comic, but it's terribly useful. It really makes the robot work very well. So in my mind, these are very continuous elements, whether I'm painting or writing or making the robots, it's the same process, and I'm thinking in the same way. This is the armadillo. I'd love to have one this size. It's actually about a little bit smaller than this robot. But the law of unintended consequences stipulates that I thought I was developing a robot system, and what really we think we now have developed is a kind of iPhone of robotics. It's an application platform. And our customers aren't interested in the robots. What they're interested in is the application that they can get as a result of mixing artificial intelligence modules, manipulator arms, tools, and sensors, and different configurations of robot and mobility system to perform a task. So what we are now building at Ross Robotics is a partnership program where companies that have useful tools, sensors, or artificial intelligence can package those in our reconfigurable format where they are recognized automatically by the robot, and the robot has automatic topology recognition so that it automatically configures itself for the user, to bring those partners into this program so that they can then add to the range of applications that the robots can perform. And thinking about this long route that I've, this non-linear route that I've traveled from being an artist in Southwest France to speaking to you today, you could imagine I might be a little disappointed, having had the ambition to be an artist, to find myself really becoming a kind of engineer. But if you ask the question, what art is for, you could say it's for diversion and entertainment, for knowing our world better and knowing ourselves better. But if you ask what technology is for, and innovation in technology, you could say it's for changing the world. So it might not be such a bad trade-off. I just mentioned Dan Staples at the beginning of my talk, who gave me this idea for talking about nonlinear thinking. I hope you haven't found this too nonlinear. And Dan will be speaking after the lunch break. So thank you very much.